Mr. Mohamed Salleh Marican is the founder and CEO of Second Chance Properties Limited, a listed company on the Singapore Stock Exchange. He performed his national service from 1968 to 1971 and left with the rank of lieutenant, starting with menswear. Tailoring in 1975, he now owns the menswear label Second Chance, women's fashion brand First Lady, and a jewelry business named as Golden Chance. In his award gallery, he owns inaugural Malay Business Award, Ernst & Young Entrepreneur of the Year Award, and the Best CEO Singapore Corporate Awards 2013. Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome Mr. Marican and let's get inspired through his valuable words.
So just to tell you one thing, in around 1960s, the legendary singer of India, Lata Mangeshkar, has sung a very beautiful song which says, Jeevan mein ek baar aana Singapore. So rather than we going to Singapore, today we have got Singapore amongst ourselves. May I request Mr. Marican to give his deliberations, please, sir.
Distinguished guests, ladies and gentlemen, a very, very good morning to all of you. Before I begin, I would like to thank the President and management of IMA for inviting and giving me this chance to speak to all you good people. I am not highly educated. I dropped out of school. And this is the first time that I have to address such a big gathering of highly intelligent people. So to boost my confidence, please give me a good round of applause. We can now concentrate on this serious topic of innovate and lead. What is the meaning of innovate? To invent or create something new? Or to make changes for the better in something already established? There is much concern and criticism that the innovation taking place in India is mainly on improving existing products and innovation and not the big bang disruptive or game-changing innovation that can lead to market dominance. They also commented that companies like Flipkart is only imitating Amazon. And they added that India is only playing catch up. How true and how serious is this? Let us take a look at Singapore, Japan and China. These three countries also had to play catch up. What do they have in common? Is that when they started their industrialization programs, it was under very dire circumstances and from a very low base. Singapore, after separation from Malaysia, did not have any resources except for its own people. It had no industries, and it had to depend on its food, energy, and even water from the outside world. China was just recovering from the failed policies of the communist system and the Mao era. Japan's industrial base was totally destroyed in their humiliating defeat during the Second World War, and they had to restart from scratch again. What are their differences? There's plenty. We will look at only some of it. Singapore population is 5.5 million. Japan, 127 million. And China, 1.4 billion. Size of country, Singapore is only a small island. Japan, four islands, four main islands and many small islands. And China, the third biggest in land area after USSR and Antarctica. So let's take a look at the chart. Ease of doing business. In Singapore, you can register a company within 1 hour. And it's not a surprise that Singapore came in number two in ease of doing business. Japan, 34. China, 78. And India is 100. But India had done well. 1 year ago, it was at 130. And it is expected to continue to do better. Corruption index. The least corrupted country in the world in 2010 was Singapore. It is now number 7. It is indeed a slippery slope. Japan is number 20, and both India and China is at 79. Adult literacy rate. Japan is top at 99%. Singapore at 96.8. China 96.4. And India 72.1. India need to focus more on this. Overall life expectancy. If you want to live longer, come and stay in Singapore. Singapore and Japanese live the longest, about 7 years more than the Chinese and 15 years more than the Indians. Innovation index. Bloomberg recently released the 2018 top 50 most innovative countries in the world. All these three countries managed to do better compared to last year. Singapore from number 6 to 3rd, Japan from 7 to 6, and China from 21 to 19. India did not make the top 50, but India had done very well over the last 3 years. Under the GII index, that is the Global Innovation Index, India was at number 81 3 years ago, and then it improved to 66 and last year was at 60. It is expected to improve further. GDP per capita. Singapore is among the richest countries in the world at $90,000. Japan, $42,000. China, $16,000. And India, $7,000. Their forms of government are also different. Although Singapore and Japan are democracies with multi-parties, and so is India. But there are different shades in the democracies. China, as you are aware, is a one-party state. These three countries had achieved remarkable economic success in spite of all these differences, in spite of having different form of government, and in spite of having taken different paths to success. China even managed it, in spite of their high corruption. Each of these countries did it their own way. Singapore did not invent the aeroplane or the container ship, but it has the best airport and the busiest seaport in the world. Today, Singapore port is number two after China. For many, many years, SIA was the best airline in the world. Today, it is number two after Qatar. How they did it is to improvise on the best practices of others. We studied what other countries did, how they operate their airport and their seaport, and we took what we believe is very relevant to Singapore, and we worked out our own formula and improved upon it. Japan did not invent the automobile, but they rose to prominence by producing reliable cars at lower prices. They started by mass producing existing products and making it as cheap as possible. But in that process, the quality was poor. But they were not unduly worried. They knew very well that they cannot compete with the established companies at that point of time. And they also are very aware that a very high percentage of the world population, 50, 60 years ago, at least 80% over, at least 80% over of the population of the world will not be able to afford good quality products. When I was a tailor in 1974, half of my customers will not touch the Japanese material. But the other half could not afford the British or the German textile. So they end up taking the second best. And so what Japan did after capturing a big slice of the world market, then they start to improve upon the quality of their products. At that time, Japan was labeled as a copycat nation, producing shoddy goods. But today, nobody thought of it. China's impressive economic success was done by positioning themselves as the factory to the world. It was achieved by improving on the manufacturing process, making it more efficient, and that result in lower prices and being able to deliver the goods speedily. China was also labeled a copycat nation. In fact, until today, people are still saying that China is the copycat king. Recently, they copied the technology of the Japanese bullet train and make their own. So what are the key factors for their success? There are several factors that are similar. Topmost of all is the role that their government played in creating a conducive ecosystem for businesses to flourish. If you look at it, everything boils back to the government. The people also play an important role. The Chinese and the Japanese are well known to be hardworking and industrious people, and that helped in the process of making themselves highly productive and highly competitive. You cannot compete in the world market if you are not highly competitive. And if you are not highly productive, you cannot be highly competitive. Pragmatic policies. Their government understand that not all policies will work, and so those that do not work, and in many cases because of change in circumstances, it has to be reversed or amended. The people too are very pragmatic, especially the Chinese. To them, if you are left behind, of course you have to first catch up. And if you cannot invent, just copy. There are so many people who become rich by copying the invention of others. Let us now take a look at what Singapore is doing to stay ahead. Singapore always worries about the future. And so they always ended up making plans for the future. We already had a master plan in 2010 to ensure that Singapore stay ahead. But in 2015, the government realized that due to the rapid changes, we need a new plan. And so, in January 2016, a high-powered committee was formed, known as the Committee on the Future Economy. It comprised of 5 cabinet ministers and 25 industry leaders. their job is to develop and recommend the economic strategies that will take Singapore forward in the next 10 years. They engage over 9,000 people that include Chamber of Commerce, industry players, unions, consultants, workers, and students. And they studied the global trends. And they re-examined every policy, every operating assumption and business model to determine what need to be retained and what need to change. And after 1 year, they came out with the 109 pages of their report. And they zoom in on 7 strategies that will ensure Singapore will continue to lead. I do not have the time to go through all these 7 strategies. It's available online, so do read it. But I would like to touch on number 6, and that is the ITM. What is the ITM? Is the industry transformation map. The objective of this ITM is to help each industry to achieve their full potential. Every industry is different. And every industry will be affected differently by all these changes. 23 industries have been identified to participate in this program. Some of them are already doing better, like logistics, than others. Struggling like the retail industry. And so, a tailored approach is required. Each industry will have their own committee to study and to figure out what problems and challenges they are currently facing, what new challenges that will likely to take place in the next few years, what type of new job skills that might be required, and whether their present workers can be retrained for these new job skills. So if we know in advance what new job skills that will be required, we can tweak or adjust our education, immigration, and labor policies before and not after it takes place. These 7 strategies will complement and strengthen each other. So do read the report for one good strategy, which the Chinese believe is just to copy the strategy of others. We can agree that to be innovative is critical in this fast-moving world of cutting-edge technology and immensely disruptive innovation. But to be innovative alone will not lead to success. The ideas and innovation need to be transformed into commercial products and move to the market quickly and at ever lower prices. This is where China has a very big advantage. Its massive market, low cost, and ability to produce goods in huge quantities speedily is attracting innovative companies from all over the world to manufacture or outsource their products in China. Let me now give my views on India. India is in a very sweet spot. You are getting younger and younger, and we Singaporeans, Japanese, and Chinese are getting older and older. You have a few hundred million young people below the age of 29. India is now the fastest growing economy in the world. And your high growth is expected to continue for many more years. And so it is predicted that India will be the second biggest economy in the world after China by 2050. And along the way, India is expected to surpass China in its population, to be the biggest country by population. With growing prosperity, it will lead to higher disposable income. And with such a massive market, the entrepreneurs, business people, and the industries of India will continue to prosper. Indian talent is formidable. Many Indians are holding top posts in top global companies all over the world. They can be attracted back to India. In fact, some are already coming back. You have a history of innovation dating back thousands of years. Indus Valley Civilization, Harappa, Mohenjo-Daro. Mohenjo-Daro invented the toilet flushing system. They had no toilet problem. Central India had its golden age during the Gupta Empire that stretched from 320 AD to 550 AD, a period of 230 years when innovation flourished. In every field, science, technology, engineering, mathematics, architecture, astronomy, philosophy, the arts, literature, it seems that in times of high prosperity is when innovation flourishes. probably you have more surpluses for more R&D. In the old days, you can support your artists, your philosophers to concentrate full time on their creativity. You also had another golden age in the 10th and 11th centuries under the Chola Empire of South India, when the adventurous Indian prince and merchants took the risky journey to Southeast Asia to conquer and dominate the trade in the lands that is now known as ASEAN. They built the biggest Buddhist monument, Borobudur, and the biggest Hindu temple, Angkor Wat. It is a testament to the prosperity of the empire and the ingenuity of the architecture and engineering. Now you have a government that is paying more attention to the business community, making the right reforms, scrapping outdated policies and introducing new ones, and this is set to continue. India is improving on its innovation, as shown by the Innovation Index. And I'm very confident you will continue to be more innovative in the years to come. So all in all, you have what it takes to regain your former glory. And in ending, I would like to wish you and Mother India all the success in taking up this great challenge to innovate and lead again. Thank you for your precious time, and thank you for your kind attention.